All right, so we're continuing on today with 1 Corinthians 12. We're getting closer to the end of the book. It'll only really be a few more weeks. Al has asked me not to do 13. He was really excited about doing 13. So if you know him, he gets really passionate about certain chapters of the Bible. So we'll look forward to that in a couple weeks. But I just want to start off, be a little unconventional. I'm going to go through verse by verse. I am going to skip a couple, and I'm going to go back to them later. But this is just about the different gifts, and it was funny to me when I was preparing this. I don't know if you guys remember, because I know I don't remember when people say things most of the time, but right after worship last Sunday, I got up and I was kind of talking about how God has gifted all of us, and that maybe your gift doesn't seem like something that can be used for the church, but God wants to use whatever your unique gifts are. As I was reading this chapter, that's kind of what this is all about, and I was reading some of the commentaries on it, and I was like, man, it's so weird that God told me that before I even really knew what I was going to talk on. But I want to start with verses 1 through 3. And it's 1 Corinthians 12, 1 through 3, if you have your Bible with you. It says, "Now about the gifts of the Spirit, brothers and sisters, I do not want you to be uninformed. You know that when you were pagans, somehow or other, you were influenced and led astray to mute idols. Therefore, I want you to know that no one who is speaking by the Spirit of God says, 'Jesus be cursed,' and no one can say, 'Jesus is Lord,' except by the Holy Spirit." So, to start off, we've given a lot of background on the Corinthian church. If you've been here for a lot of the sermons, you've heard a lot about that whole culture. It was a crazy culture. It was one of the most, I don't want to say wicked, but it probably was one of the most wicked cultures we've seen. There was all sorts of practices that even today would be like, okay, that's not okay at all. You can't do that. But that was the culture they lived in. There was a lot of demon worship and things like that. And there was a lot of, you know, just enthusiasm, even in the outside of the church. And it also is inside of the church. So that's kind of what this context is. But the part that always stood out to me as a little bit weird and out of place growing up and reading this was the part that says nobody can say Jesus is cursed unless they're outside of the church, and nobody can say Jesus is Lord unless they have the Holy Spirit. That part always stood out to me. But as I was reading, Barclay, he's a theologian who wrote about the Corinthians, and Jesus be cursed was something that was, both of these were battle cries essentially, and the Jesus be cursed was kind of what they were saying, and it was a few reasons they could have used it, and there were a few reasons that it definitely did happen. One of them was, you know, Paul, who was writing this, used to go out and persecute the Christians, and he used to be part of killing Christians, and something they would have them say, like, it was similar to some things you hear nowadays. It's, you know, either you renounce Jesus or I'm going to kill you. And that was kind of what would happen. They would have to say, oh, cursed be Jesus. And words were a lot heavier then. People took the words very seriously that they were saying. You know, nowadays we might say things and it's not a big deal to us. Curses back then were a life and death thing. If you curse somebody, you were essentially killing them. But another reason then was, like I said, the Jews didn't want that, and they were killing Christians. But then in other situations, if they suspected you might be a Christian and you wanted to worship with them in the temples or the tabernacle, you would have to say, cursed be Jesus. And they even thought this because in some of their minds, there was an Old Testament verse they kind of took out of context that said, you know, anybody who is hung under a tree is cursed. And they said, well, Jesus was on a cross, so essentially he was on a tree, so he must not be, you know, who he said he was. And then the time of Roman persecution, this goes to another time of, they would make you say, cursed be Jesus, or you're going to die. There was, the Roman government for a while was supportive of the Christians, and then they turned into, we're going to kill all of you, and you could end up being beheaded or in the Colosseum if you didn't say, cursed be Jesus. But then here's the other thing, was Jesus is Lord. And like I said, words were a lot heavier back then. This isn't just kind of, we use Lord and like King and Master really loosely nowadays, but saying Jesus is Lord then essentially was saying, I don't follow the emperor, I don't follow this, I follow Jesus, Jesus has my entire life. He is greater than the emperor, which you can see why Paul would say, unless you have the Spirit of God in you, you're not going to say that, because saying that can get you put to death. So it really gave that idea of complete devotion to Jesus. And that's just kind of a side note, that's not really what this whole message is about, but I just thought that was really kind of an interesting thing that, with our context now, reading that, you're like, well, anybody could say Jesus is Lord, but not in the way that they were thinking. Nobody can claim that Jesus is the master of their lives and that they'll die for Jesus before they give their life to anything else. I'm going to continue on. Like I said, I'm going to skip a few things right now. I'm going to go to verse 8. It says, "To one there is given through the Spirit a message of wisdom, to another a message of knowledge, by means of the same Spirit." All right, so wisdom and knowledge are two things Al brings up a lot. He knows the Greek and Hebrew a lot better than I do of the Bible, but there's the Sophia and the Gnosis. The wisdom was more than just we think of somebody who is wise. It's something that comes from a deep relationship with God that, you know, you have a deeper understanding of just spiritual matters and just life itself. And then there's the knowledge, which is how to put those spiritual practice and or the spiritual things into practice and, you know, use your gifts for the church. And that could even be, a lot of times back then, your carpentry skills or just your skills with going out and doing money things and stuff like that. So it's saying practical things, and then there's also the spiritual wisdom. We're going to continue on in verse 9. It says, "To another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by that one Spirit, to another miraculous powers, to another prophecy, to another distinguishing between spirits, and to another speaking in different kinds of tongues, and still to another the interpretation of those tongues." Okay, so the first thing in there is faith. And that's not just, he's not just talking about, oh, I believe in God. It's talking about the kind of faith that would drive you to do things that normally people would not do for God. And one example, I know I bring him up a lot, and if you haven't read his book, which I'm sure none of you have, you definitely should go read it. Victor Plymire, it's actually, the book is written by his son, but he was one of the early Pentecostal missionaries, and he went into Tibet where really no Westerner had ever journeyed. He spent all of his, or a lot of his life there, and he had a really deep faith. If you read his story, you know, the whole area was in turmoil. There was invasions by the Chinese. There was a civil war there. And his denomination was like, you need to leave. Everybody needs to leave. You're going to come home now. He decided to stay. And then it came to the point where he had to leave because literally every village he had been in prior got taken over right as he left. And they were killing any Westerners. Anybody who didn't believe like they believed was getting put to death. It didn't matter Christian or not. It was anybody who wasn't like them was being put to death. And he decided, you know what, I can get on a boat and I can go back to America. But instead, I'm going to take this really long journey through the Himalayan mountains. I'm going to pass out scriptures to people. I'm going to talk to every village I meet. I'm going to go all the way through the Himalayan mountains and get out through India, which no Westerner had ever survived that journey. And most of the Tibetans would not make that entire journey. They would go little segments to one village. So that's the kind of faith I'm talking about. People didn't live through that journey, and it wasn't people who were outside of Tibet that could live through that journey. That's the kind of faith he's talking about, and that's why it's a spiritual gift. It's not just, you know, a lot of us can say, oh, we believe in Jesus, but would you really go to those ridiculous lengths? The next thing is healing. Back then, and even in a lot of countries now, healing from God was a big thing. A lot of the religious people would go to the temple before they would go to a doctor because they believed they were going to get healed. And there is a lot of historical documentation that they actually did get healed. And a lot of the writers say things that they wouldn't just write, and they wouldn't, because paper was expensive back then, they wouldn't document healing after healing in these different temples if they didn't happen. And like I said, still today, it's a big thing in a lot of parts of the world. You hear stories all the time. If you talk to people who spend their lives in the more remote areas of the world, you know, people that believe the spiritual side of things more, healing is a big deal to them. And it's even this part of the Bible, this time period, is when the anointing with oil came to be. You know, it was, you're anointed with oil with the believing that you're going to be healed. And I can tell you from my life that that is not something that has died. And a lot of these people, or a lot of people say, oh, these gifts are gone, but I've seen people healed of leukemia, I've seen people healed of other things, so that is still a thing, and there are people that are gifted with that ministry of being able to heal. Or not them healing, but through God. Continuing on, I read verse 10, I believe. Miraculous powers are, it's referring to, most likely, we can't say definitively, but he's most likely referring to dealing with demons. And back then, any mental issue or anything like that, if somebody had mental problems, it was attributed to demonic works. And I mean, in a lot of cases, it probably was. But traditionally, the church, and even today, has dealt a lot with helping people mentally and just people emotionally. And that was a big thing in a lot of the world today, and it even happens in America. It's just kept more undercover. Demonic acts are a big thing. And there's a story I debated telling, but there was a girl I knew in the Marine Corps who would tell you, she was from the Samoan Islands, and she was actually from the tribal Samoan Islands. She had the whole tribal tattoo done the old-fashioned way. But she would tell you that she was possessed, and she didn't want it to leave. It was a family demon that stayed with them. And we saw it manifest a couple times. I only saw it once, and it was a scary thing. She picked up, now she's a girl and not much bigger than the average girl, she picked up and threw a 250-pound guy. And see, the problem with it is, you know, somebody who wants that in their life, they're not going to keep it out of their life even if it's cast out. But the church has historically had a part in playing with that and healing people of those issues and setting them free. Then prophecy, yes, it's talking about, you know, we think of the prophetic books and the prophets in the Old Testament. It is talking about that, but it's also referring to preaching and teaching. A lot of the times in the Bible when it says prophecy, they're talking about just somebody who has a close relationship with God and they can, you know, they know things from God that they can teach people and they can tell people, you're doing this wrong, you can't be living your life like this. So that's kind of what it's talking about. And that is a gift that some people have. They're way better at teaching the truths of God and like the deeper levels than others. And then distinguishing spirits is something that's kind of weird, but like I was saying earlier when I first opened up, the Corinthian church was in an area where there was all sorts of craziness. And I mean, we even see it sometimes now today in some of the Pentecostal churches that take things too far, and you can tell it's not something of God. They're just doing craziness. That's what it's talking about. It's somebody who can tell, okay, this is from God and this is not from God. And the Bible even speaks to sometimes people do things and try to make it look like the Spirit of God, but in reality it's from the devil and it's pulling people away from God. It's more look at me and focus on this that's happening instead of focusing on God. So that one is an important thing, especially if you're going to not have a church where there's any, you know, worshiping ecstatically and there's no spiritual gifts that are emphasized. It's not as big of a deal, but I mean, we want to be close to God. We want to experience all these gifts that he has. So it is important to have people that can say, look, I think that maybe you're doing this and it's not really from God and you don't need to be pushing it like that. Yes, it's an awkward conversation to have with somebody, but I'd much rather have that happen than somebody be all about themselves and be distracting from everyone else. And then tongues is, I mean, a lot of us have experienced it. It's something that spiritual utterances from God, and also some instances in the New Testament are also talking about being able to be understood by various languages. And then the interpretation of tongues is another big one that goes along with that. It's the gift that makes the tongues a blessing to the rest of the congregation, because if nobody understands it, nobody understands the prophetic word that God has given you, then it's not really helping anyone. So I know this is going to be kind of a short message, but after reading all this, and I'd been thinking about it, and I'd done researching into a couple different people who write on the Corinthians, I was like, well, what does this mean today? Like, why am I teaching on this? And yes, it's good to know all these things, but that essentially was a Bible study of what does that mean? And the first thing that came to my mind was, these gifts are alive and active today. There are a lot of churches that don't say that, and they say, oh, that was just back then, that's not now. But like I said earlier, I've seen amazing healings. I know people that were on their deathbed in the hospital. They were told, you're on your way out, like you need to say your final goodbyes. And the next day after being prayed over and anointed with oil, they were back home in 100% health. You know, I've seen people healed of mental problems and, you know, being so depressed that they wanted to take their life, becoming somebody who is happy and joyful and people want to be around. And I've seen faith, like that story of Victor Plymire that I said, you know, I've seen stuff like that in my life, that people that have faith that's so amazing that you're like, man, how do you go out into the deepest parts of the Congo where there's people that say they're going to kill you if you come back? How do you go to their leader and say, no, but Jesus loves you? Because I've met people like that, and it just blows my mind when they're like, oh yeah, this tribe is a Satan-worshipping tribe, and they kill anybody who comes in. And I went up and I made friends with their leader, and I'm like, man, I wouldn't go up to him. But all these things, and I mean, in our service, we've had some really cool moments of God and interacting with the Spirit of God, and we've seen the gifts. So don't let people tell you that these are dead or those aren't for us today. God wants us to have those gifts and be part of them. And the next thing is, we need to get rid of our traditionally really narrow goals of spiritual gifting. And this is kind of what I was talking about last week. We have the idea that, and I'm going to go more on this next week because I'm going to do the second half of 1 Corinthians 12 next week, but, you know, we have these mindsets that this person's gift is higher than another, or the person who can speak in tongues, a lot of times, unfortunately, in Assemblies of God, that comes into play where you see people that are like, oh, well, you haven't spoken in tongues, so obviously you're not close to God. That's not true, and I can point you to Bible verses that prove that that's not true. And people think, oh, the pastor is a preacher, and he has the gift of prophecy and teaching, so he must be above this other person. But we need all of the gifts equally, and that's what I'm going to go into next week. But, you know, we talked a little bit on Wednesday. Diane, her gift of the church administration, I am so glad and we're all blessed that Diane can do that. Maybe we don't see that she's doing it every week, but the church wouldn't be going very well. It'd be a really dark service, and we'd be just using our voices. And then, you know, TJ leads worship. That's a gift that I don't have. I got fired from a worship team once. Apparently they didn't want to play metal in church. I don't know. But then Hunter in the sound booth, that's a gift that I don't have. I'm technologically challenged. If we have me running, which we did for a while, it doesn't go well. And then, you know, Audra can do writing for the church and writing for different things, and she can reach people with words in a way that my writing isn't going to reach them. You know, and then Bailey back there with the kids, she is so much better with kids than I am. And we need all of these things, and you might not think that your specific gift is that valuable, but I'm promising you that God has a way to use you in what you're good at, regardless of if it seems a little crazy. And that's actually what I shared, you know. A metal band reached a lot more people that would have never been reached because they decided to serve God with everything they had. And then just the whole thing of Paul kind of talks about it. It's all from the same Spirit of God that gives us these things. We can't look at one person. Yes, we can look at people that love God deeply and have a deep relationship and say, oh man, I want a relationship like that. But don't look at somebody who has one gift and say, man, I wish I had that gift and I can't serve God as well as them. I'll never be Billy Graham because I can't preach like him. I can't come up with the things he says, and he doesn't even use notes. Like, that, it blows my mind. If you watch his stuff, he doesn't prepare his sermons. He just gets up there and he shares. But, you know, God gave us all these gifts, and no one can boast about your gift. If you do have one of those greater gifts that are in people's eyes, if you have one of those gifts that's a public gift, don't ever get in your head that, oh man, look how great I'm doing. Look how much I'm bringing people into the church because God has given me the gift of evangelism. Look at it as, man, I'm serving, and how can I help these other people serve and get closer to God? You know, you each have those gifts, as I was saying. So if you haven't figured out what you can use to serve God yet, come talk to somebody, because I promise that God wants to use you, and we'll help you figure out what you're good at and how it can apply to the church. And that was something I actually, the church we went to before here had a lot of weird issues. It was people who came from the business world and said, you know what, we're starting a church. And they didn't have any of the spiritual training side, but that is one thing they really got right, even though they didn't necessarily apply it correctly. They said, like, hey, we want you to fit in wherever you work. I don't care if your gift is writing, we're going to have you write something. I don't care if your gift is media, we're going to have you make videos for us. You know, that was just really cool to me that they wanted to make a place for your gift. And if we're like that, I think the church is going to flourish a whole lot more. And even if we don't have all the other aspects, because I don't think this church has every aspect down either, but if we're willing to work with everybody's gift, man, it's going to be a cool church. So, I know it's a little bit short of a message, but just please come and talk to us.
Amen.
Now, I'm going to open it up to any comments or questions or discussion that you have and you've been thinking about.
I just think it's neat that God can work with anybody with any talent, and he can make us in some fashion useful for his kingdom.
Amen.
That other people can be blessed and can benefit from it.
Does anybody have any stories of any weird, or not necessarily weird, but different ways that they've seen people or God, or has used you and yourself to bless the church that a lot of times people don't think about? And it's not bragging, because it's like, it's helping people get the idea, because I know for a long time there's certain things about me that I was really good at that I struggled with, you know, how's God going to use that? And I saw your hand go up a little bit.
Well, when my mom went to college, she got an education degree. She got a degree to teach high school, I think. And she went and taught high school for 2 years and figured out she didn't like it, so she didn't do it. So then they became missionaries. So for a long time, she didn't use her education degree. But recently, whenever they moved to the Philippines, my dad got into a ministry where they print children's school books. So now my mom's able to use her ministry degree to help look over the school books and make sure the school books are teaching correctly and make sure that they're using that knowledge that she didn't use for a long time, and now it's coming really into play. That's what I was thinking about when you were saying, like, God using gifts that you don't think about and things they don't use for a while.
What you just said kind of reminded me of Audra's mom. You know, she's fairly handicapped. She can't get out very much, and she has a degree, and she's really good with English. So for a long time, she felt bad that, you know, I'm stuck at home. I can go to church, but I can't get out there. I can't be out working with people every day. And then she got a job teaching English to people overseas over video conferencing and over the phone. And it's something she realized, it's not fast. You don't get to talk about God quickly with these people because it's not, you know, that's not her job. It's not a Christian organization. But she is allowed to answer their questions and work with them on their English on things. So, you know, she's been able to help talk a lot or with a lot of people who don't understand Christianity in other parts of the world. And she did that from her living room just because she was good at English and had a degree. You know, well, yes, her degree is ministry, so that helped with the talking. But she's really good with English. So, you know, you can, no matter who you are, and even if you're stuck at home, God has a place for you and God has a ministry for you. Yes.
As someone that's older, I know that we look at life in decades, you know, like when we're in our 20s, how God's using us and what's going to happen in our life. And we might think when we're in our 20s and 30s that we're not going to be used just like he said, you know, about his mom. But in every decade and every age of your life, God's going to use you some specific way. And I just want to encourage people to know that, younger people especially, don't get discouraged, because your life's going to change over and over and over. Your priorities are going to change, and God's going to use you differently. And whatever you've got, whatever talents you've got, God will use it. I want to say something about Diane. Diane's ministry is keeping the church going, an organization. She's very organized. But she also works in that kitchen and all around and makes sure things are right. And I'll go back there and try to help her. And sometimes I do and sometimes I don't, because that's not my ministry. But one day we were supposed to take somebody out to eat. And Al was gone and we were supposed to see that they got to go to eat. And so somebody else was taking them. And they said, well, y'all come with us anyway. And I asked Diane, I said, you want to go? She said, I'll go if you go, because I don't talk much. And I do. And so we kind of fit together like that. You know, she doesn't talk much, but I can carry on a conversation with anybody. So Diane's got a good ministry.
And something, too, it gets in a lot of people's head that you have to be in vocational ministry. I see it at least at Southeastern. You know, if you're in a Christian college, people get it in their mind, if I'm not doing vocational ministry, then like that, I'm missing something. I'm not working in a church, so I'm obviously doing something wrong. But God has a place for you with your gifts and talents. Somebody said it really well, one of my professors. He's like, if you cannot be a pastor, he's like, if you can do anything else, don't be a pastor. He's like, it's not going to be fun. So, but and he was being genuine about that. If God hasn't called you to be a pastor, that's not what God wants for you. And Lillian, she's not a pastor, but she cuts hair and she reaches a lot of people. You know, and she uses that for God, and that's the whole key, is whatever God has gifted you with, use it for God and lay it down at his feet and say, how can I use this to serve you? And Lillian talks to a lot of people every week.
I tell you another thing, too. A lot of people have a prayer ministry. I mean, they don't reach out to people, but they're at home praying, they're interceding, and they're helping people that way. And people that just have that ministry, that's the most important to me.
Yes, my husband, even though he's had a disability, he's paralyzed, he has the gift of mechanic and like doing lawn service and all that. He does all that for our church. And our pastor would always lift him up and tell everybody, you know, that, hey, he's in a wheelchair and he does more than everybody. Amen. He's walking around the church and he always keeps it looking good, and the cemetery and everything, and church van working and people was forever calling him on the phone like, listen to my car, can you tell what's wrong with it? And I said, that's not only your gift, but we need to start charging.
And that's what I mean too, and we're going to close up, but anything can be a gift and you can use it for God. I know people who, like you just said, maintenance is a gift and you can use it to serve the church and, you know, organization. Yes, ma'am.
My daughter can sing. She can sing.
And that is a gift.
She has a beautiful voice. She's shy, but if you get her up there, she can do it. Just letting you all know. So she's not going to say anything, but I'm saying it.
Well, maybe we'll get to hear that
gift. Get her up there.
Yes, Ann.
When we're prepared, when different ones are prepared, you know, for what they're going to be, maybe there's not a place for them right then. Maybe it's because that God is not ready. It's not His time for them to do what He wants them to do.
Amen.
Definitely. And I think Al, when he comes back, would definitely attest to that. Most of you have heard, you know, he didn't pastor for 15 years. No churches opened up for him. And he worked in the business world and taught as a professor. And he thought, well, maybe God doesn't want me to be a pastor anymore. And then they called him up one day and said, hey, we want you to start a church. So you never know. God may just not have that spot for you quite yet. But you can still serve Him regardless. And you can still be the part of that body that you need to be. Anybody else before we close out? Yes, Sandra.
I was talking about this last night with Josh. Sometimes God can also, what?
Speak up.
Oh, sorry. I feel like sometimes God can use difficult situations in our lives to reveal gifts that we have and that we didn't really know was there. I said last Sunday that I was picked on and bullied most of my high school, my time at LCS, basically. And God used that to help reveal to me that I have a gift of kindness to people. And I told Josh this last night. I'm not trying to boast, I'm just saying. But I told Josh this last night, like, I learned throughout all those years at LCS that, like, you only see what true love is and what true kindness is until you see what it's not. And I learned that throughout my time at LCS, and I didn't want people to feel the way that I did. So I made it my goal to be kind to people, and God revealed that to me. And Josh told me yesterday, or last night, he was like, when I met you, he's like, you were one of the sweetest people that I've ever met. And I was like, that kind of really hit me, because I was like, it's really weird. I've never really considered myself that. And I just thought I'd share that. So sometimes God can use difficult situations in our lives to reveal things to us that we don't normally see is there.
Amen. One thing she said that was really significant was she made that her goal. That was significant.
That was something I actually meant to say in the sermon. But, you know, all these things, you're not going to ever develop those gifts. You might have that little seed of the gift, but if you don't use it for God and you don't develop that relationship with God and seek to serve Him through it, your gift is never going to be what it could be, and you're never going to, you know, move the church in the way that it could if you don't take that time to be intentional about that relationship with God and about how you can use what God has given you. You know, you're never going to develop it to be as amazing as it can be. So, yeah, that is a good point. You know, it has to be intentional. You can't just accidentally end up being the best sound guy. All right.
And maybe we're not ready the way God wants us to be.
All right, I'm going to close in prayer, and then we can fellowship some more or go home and prepare for the food for the Super Bowl. Dear Lord, we just thank You for all the people in here and just the relationships that we have and the people who share and, you know, just enrich our message a little bit more. Lord, we just thank You that You love us and that You've given each of us just a piece of the puzzle that we need to build the church up and be who You want us to be. Just help us to remember that You want us to serve You in whatever way, and You don't ask us to be, you know, the next best preacher. You don't ask us to be the best finance person. You ask us to be who You've made us to be. In Your name we pray. Amen.
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 All right, so.